Welcome to the future, where the glass is half full and you'll need new glasses, where you'll be jumping from conclusions.
The past is annulled, and a new future is born.
Never before in history has so much meant so little to so many. AD on the radio.
So back in 1961, a guitar player called Rick Nielsen started playing locally in Rockford, Illinois. Just gigging around town. He played in a band called Bow Weevils. And then he formed a band called Fuse. Fuse actually snagged a record deal. They dropped an album in 1970 on Epic Records. Nobody cared. Didn't do too well. Record label didn't care. Public didn't care. But Rick Nielsen kept playing, kept gigging, kept working. And he really wanted to work with a lead singer, a guy called Robin Zander. Robin Zander was another hardworking musician. And he was like, hey, could you join Fuse? I think you're the greatest frontman ever. And I think, you know, nobody cared about our first album. And I think that this could make a big difference. And Robin Zander was in a band called Zander and Kent. And he was like, I can't be infused because, well, I have a 3-summer residency in the Wisconsin Dells, a vacation spot. He had a 3-summer residency at the Piccadilly Club in the Wisconsin Dells. But after that 3-summer residency wrapped up, they managed to reconnect and they formed Cheap Trick, who really, as much as they put out records, didn't do especially well in terms of having hits. But it was their work ethic. Maybe it was a Midwestern work ethic. A lot of people that come from that hardy Norwegian and Scandinavian stock used to plowing fields in freezing cold, miserable winters have a work ethic like you wouldn't believe. So maybe it was a work ethic, but they just kept plugging away. They wanted to be professional musicians, and whether or not their record label or their management or their promotions company or whoever the hell it was managed to make it happen for them in terms of hit records, they just kept playing and kept playing and had the strongest live show going. And interestingly enough, it was their live show. It was their live show captured at Budokan in Japan that made them break. Everybody knows Cheap Trick live at Budokan. Big deal. Turning point for that band. And it speaks to the type of people that they are and the type of people that they were, that it wasn't about a record label or a hit single or something of that nature. It was about hard working musicians rolling up their sleeves, going out, taking it to the people every single night and playing the best show that they could play, regardless of what was going on externally to that. Hard work. Hard work, determination. You might have the best job in the world. It might be the most fun in the world, but you roll up your sleeves and you do that. You do that job better than the person sitting next to you, and you'll get somewhere. Something I've always believed in. And I think it's no accident that a band that is widely regarded as being the hardest working band in rock is still going. And they're not just getting out there and taking it to the people for the sake of nostalgia and memorabilia. No, they put out new records. They mean just as much to 16-year-old kids now as they did to their parents when they were 16 years old. You can probably take it back 2 generations. They've been playing music since the 70s. It's an interesting dichotomy. Hard work will get you where you're going. And our guests on the show today are Cheap Trick. They're about to be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. We're going to talk to them about all that, including how hard work got them where they're going. Talent is cheaper than table salt. What separates a talented individual from the successful one is a lot of hard work. Stephen King, thank you so much for hanging out.
left and right come together for fundamental truths. AD on the radio, on Twitter at ADSXE.
Working, running that rat race at that pace, and that place will leave a bad taste for anyone, everyone working day after day. So, buddy, I gotta say, for you, there's gotta be a better way. Yeah, and you do what they told ya. Company man, bullet, a mindless little soldier. How can you live like that and maintain your composure before it's begun? Your life's already freaking over. Yeah, I do what I want, when I want.
So, really, today is all about the fact that we are being. Well, we're having a little brush with greatness today is what we're doing. The guys in Cheap Trick are going to be stopping by to talk about, well, being Cheap Trick. There's a lot to talk about, not least of which is the fact that they are being inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and that they have a new album. We're very excited about that. So let's just kind of sort of bide time today until we get to the fact that Cheap Trick are rolling through. And like I said, we are enjoying a brush with greatness by taking a look at the events of today in our segment, My Witness News. In no way, shape, or form fair, certainly not balanced. Oh, wait, before we do that, further to our conversation. Further to our conversation about the value of hard work and your attitude when it comes to making your way in this world. Finding a way to feel good about doing whatever it is you're doing is so important. Whatever it is you're doing, be the best at it. Be the best at it. And do whatever you can to make the people around you feel good. Like this guy, a Walmart employee who can do a perfect Scooby-Doo and Shaggy, making people around him smile every single day. Check this out. It's freaking genius. It's on my blog up at Real Radio 104.1 or realradio.fm. Yeah, it's up on my blog there, or you can check it out at thebuzz.com or rock1053.com. I'll tweet it. That's what I'll do, so you can check this out. But have a listen.
Whatever you like.
Yep. I'll tell you my life story. Like a long time ago when me and Scoo were, like, getting scared by monsters, we kind of said we didn't like this type of thing anymore.
Well, it was too scary.
Like, so we applied a job at Walmart, and we were like, we can get paid in food.
Yeah, food.
Like, food's the best stuff we can ever have, man.
Yeah, even Mark thinks so.
It's genius. Do yourself a favor. Check it out. And you know what? Look, a lot of people would say that if you are ringing folks up at Walmart, you don't necessarily have a huge reason to smile. Now, if that is your job, if you are somebody that rings folks up at Walmart, or you're a greeter or you're a bagger or whatever it is you do, there's no slight against you. But I've had friends that work at Walmart in every single capacity. From door greeters to checkout folks to people that run entire stores. And again, not casting aspersions, not making any assumptions about the way Walmart is run, but I found the people that I know that worked at Walmart to be top to bottom, no matter what they did. The common thread that ran through them was they were miserable and hated every single day of their lives. But this guy found a way to make people smile and make the people around him smile. And there is tremendous value in that. Something that I'm taking with me into today. A day where I would happily shank the vast majority of the people that I see in the halls, just in principle. Funkhauser, how are you and what is going on in the world?
This is My Witness News. In no way, shape, or form fair and certainly not balanced. And now, super producer to the stars, Barry Funkhauser.
I think I'm stoked. I think that's the right word to use for today's Cheap Trick time. I'm so stoked.
Very much looking forward to having inexpensive prank on the show.
Yeah.
it's pretty.
It's very rare that
awesome.
That a band has like more than three singles, and it's even rarer that they want to hang out with us. So
yeah. Yeah, no, like great. I said, it'll be our brush with greatness. We're very much looking forward to that today, and that's really all today is about. But we got to kill time until they, I hope we get them, like, we're not going to get them fresh when they do these sorts of things. They like, how many interviews do you think they will have done by the time they got here?
14, probably.
So, yeah, they're going
to
be miserable.
Back to back to back. Boom, bang, boom, bang.
They're going to be miserable by the time they get here. So, like, it's my goal whenever I have two goals whenever I do interviews. One, I like to try and elicit something out of them that they haven't spoken about before. Two, Two, I like to make them forget that they're on a long, miserable press tour. Like, my goal for Cheap Trick is I would like them to have fun when they come in here. Because they're probably...
I can see them in the other room, and they look pretty happy, but, you know...
Well, that's because they're coming in here. They know. They've heard the
yeah.
show.
Yeah. Epic lunch right now, it looks like.
They haven't heard the show. Okay. Well, we're excited to have Cheap Trick here. What else is going on?
The percentage of the world's elderly is expected to double by 2050.
You know, apparently, I've been hearing about this. Like, people that can't find a job, just hang in there. Because there's going to be a job surplus in the not-too-distant future. Less and less people are breeding. You know, the idea of idiocracy. You know, smart, hardworking people recognize having a child is a massive responsibility, so they're not just popping out kids
no more baby boomers.
At the age of 17 years old. And so the population that is of the age that you need to fill positions in the workforce is getting thinner and thinner. So it might be tough to find a job now, but it will not be. There's actually supposed to be a job surplus that we're on the verge of. It's an interesting time to be around. But meanwhile, the percentage of the world's elderly is expected to double by 2050. Yeah. Maybe it will take us a lot longer to replace Rush Limbaugh than we thought it would.
Damn it.
I guess that means that NCIS will last through at least season 47.
I hope it stays around long enough for me to like it.
My goal is really just to get old. Like, I would happily skip over the next 30 years and move straight to Del Boca Vista in Florida now, get all over that shuffleboard court, eat early bird dinners, and play Nirvana records on the oldie station. That's really what I'm working toward. More news when we get back. Plus, don't forget Cheap Trick. Yay! Cheap Trick.
Don't get the blues, get all the news, we mean all of you guys out there in Radio Land.
All aboard!
He's back, AD on the radio.
Give it up, yeah, give it up, yeah. Bring this on, come on, come on.
Here I come again, coming again, taking it back to the place where I'm picking up the pen and before I started, it's already...
Really, today on the show, like we said before, we are just killing time until our brush with greatness, until we get a moment to talk to Cheap Trick about their new album and the fact that they're being inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. But until they get here, until they're done eating lunch, Funkhauser can see them in the other room.
Yes. They look still hungry, on their way toward being full,
mm-hmm.
signing things and... Yeah. Trying to get the Wi-Fi.
You know, they're
password.
Rock stars. They're rock stars. And you know, like, as we're doing this, this airs at all different times all over the country, but they're rock stars. I'm going to have to guess this is their first meal of the day. I don't think they're eating lunch.
I just taught a class on how to log on to the internet here. Everybody's like, what's the password? And it's all, you know, tragically long because we're in the offices.
Yeah.
Like, lowercase q, right. 7, no. Here, let me do it. So, yeah.
You know, I always wonder, you know how you unhook from building Wi-Fi when you work a corporate job? If you want to surf porn, you do it on your own data plan at work. I've heard. But I wonder what happens when you get people like Cheap Trick coming through. You know, like, who knows what Robin Zander is into? You know, it's just like, Funkhauser, somebody use your password to log into Barely Legal Cleft Palate Midget Amputees.com. Can you come into the office and bring everything in your desk with you? Like, no, it's Robin Zander from Cheap Trick. No, it wasn't.
But I can tell you, like, some inside info is Robin Zander does have a lot of bookmarks on his laptop. I wasn't able to see them, but a lot of them.
Robin Zander from Cheap Trick is married to a Playboy playmate.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That explains the smile.
It does explain the smile. But you know what? He's married to a Playboy playmate, but I think they've been together for like a really long time. It's not like he trades out various smoking hot chicks like every couple of years.
I disavow, okay?
Yeah, he's married to, I think, Pamela Stein. They have like two kids, and he's been married to her for a really long time as well. So not only an expert in Cheap Trick, not only experts at working hard at music, but working hard at relationships too. So yeah, there you go. There's probably a life lesson in there for all of us. But until we do that, let's talk about what's going on in the world. What is going on in the world, Funkhauser?
Well, Donald Trump just became a grandfather for the 8th time. That's eight.
eight Donald Trump grandkids.
Donald Trump Jr.
You know, Donald Trump, as the Trump crazy train, continues to make stops at what people are calling numerous crazy stations. I get more and more protective of Donald Trump and the people that like him. Not because I'm a Trump guy. I want to be very careful how I phrase this. I'm not a Trump guy. I'm not a Trump supporter. I think Trump is a bad idea. But there's lots of people that do think he's a good idea. Some of whom are booger-eating morons that drag knuckles. Others who are some of the most intelligent people I've ever met. As is the case with any candidate. You look into their sea of potential voters, you're going to find genuine numbnuts, and you're going to find people that are very smart, very thoughtful, that have great, cogent, logical points about why they should be elected. And I think Donald Trump, as much as I have absolutely no desire to see him as president, Donald Trump is someone who I wish people would respect his supporters. Not the supporters who are going to be horrible to folks that don't believe what they believe. But the division that Donald Trump and his run for president is causing is such a damaging thing. Not only within the GOP, the right, the Republican Party, the conservatives, whatever you want to call folks like that, but just across the country. Because it's like, you're going to vote for Trump? You're clearly stupid. You're clearly evil. You're clearly a Nazi. And that kind of blanket thinking, which, by the way, is what Donald Trump's campaign is based on, is such a dangerous thing. So I would ask you, when someone says, I'm voting for Donald Trump and you don't agree with him, or I'm voting for Hillary and you don't agree with them, or I'm voting for Cruz and you don't agree with them, or I'm voting for Bernie Sanders, and people go, commie, have a little respect. Just try. Look, the political arena has degenerated to the worst example of buffoonery and inhumanity that I think we've seen in a very, very long time. And it is so important for us to hold on to what makes us good as people. So important to hold on to what makes us good as people and makes us kind and compassionate and caring toward the folks that believe different things in us. Look, the field of potential candidates right now, people say like, oh, they're just a bunch of petulant children. I'll go one better. They're a bunch of petulant children that need a timeout. They need to be stuffed into a bathroom and told to think about what they did with a bar of soap in their mouth. Those are the people that could be ostensibly running the country and leader of the free world moving forward. And that's not a good thing or a happy place for any of us. But I would tell you that as you watch all this tomfoolery take place, you do everything you can to hold on to your humanity. You do everything you can to hold on to your compassion for your fellow human being. You recognize that we're all Americans. We're all on the same side. We all ultimately, probably for the most part, want the same thing. We just have different ideas about how to get there. And if we stop and we're respectful and we maybe even listen to each other every once in a while, we might learn something from one another. So don't be a victim of the division that literally every candidate is causing at the moment.
Speaking of that
said, go on.
No, you first.
Well, that said, I've got a joke about Donald Trump's grandchildren. Donald Trump. He's become a grandfather for the 8th time. And I think people are saying that the baby is a lot like his grandpa. He screams and yells when he wants something, babbles incoherently, has wispy little tufts of hair. The only difference being that the kid is way more qualified to run a country. There we go. Now, what were you saying?
Yes. So something happened with him this week where he said something on TV and then
and then people got mad?
And then
stupid and ugly?
But then he released a press release saying that he didn't mean to say what he said, and he said he feels the opposite. And he released the press release before the thing that he said on TV aired. So I think we're in a similar situation where we're doing this before it airs in Orlando. So I think you should say something and then, like, pull a Trump and then retract it before it airs.
Retract it before it airs?
Yeah.
I don't know. I like that's like preemptive hypocrisy. Like that's like I can't, you know, I find it hard to be hypocritical at all. And I'm not saying, well, I find it hard to be hypocritical because my moral fiber is so tightly woven. No, it's just that, you know, I'm a big believer in owning the things that you do and say.
No, I didn't mean to say that.
I disavow, okay?
Okay. What else?
Sibian rebels backed by the CIA.
Wait, Sibian rebels? Sibian rebels? A bunch of people that plan to rebel against the state with a sex toy that pornographic actresses ride on the Howard Stern show? What are these Sibian rebels doing?
Simple mistake there. Come on.
No, simple mistake, very funny mistake, though. I'm not pointing it out because you made a mistake. I'm making fun of you. I'm pointing it out because it's hilarious.
Calling all Sibian rebels. I'd like to talk to you.
I'd like to meet you.
No, Syrian rebels.
Oh, yeah.
Completely different rebels backed by the CIA are now fighting other Syrian rebels backed by the Pentagon.
Yeah. This is why we as a country, we as people, forget the nonsense that happens at the higher echelons of power. Places that we don't even want to know about or go to. Like, this is why we as people must look out for one another. This division. Alex Jones' ugly cry. The division that starts at the top and works its way to the bottom can only be cured by unity that starts at the bottom and works its way to the top. I promise you. But Syrian rebels backed by the CIA are now fighting other Syrian rebels backed by the Pentagon. So, yeah. Joke's on you, everyone who says the Middle East is a hopeless, never-ending cluster F. Division starts from the top down. Unity begins from the bottom and works its way up.
Holding out for Sibian rebels myself.
Yeah. With Sibian rebels, you definitely want to work your way up from the bottom. I don't know. Go on.
Real classy. Why don't we just go to the story?
Police arrested a stripper. Get this. Who bit a customer in the crotch while giving him a lap dance at a Wisconsin strip club.
I hate it when that happens. I mean, how horrible. I've never been a lap dance person.
Too hard.
I've never paid for a lap dance. I've gotten a lap dance at someone's bachelor party when someone was like, hey, I was like, what? Okay. I've gotten like 2-3 lap dances in my life.
College girls? Come on.
No, I mean, I've had to work in a lot of strip clubs because radio, but I've never been a lap dance buyer. It's just, what is it, $20 a dance? Is that what it is? Something like that? I'm not sure exactly.
I wouldn't know.
But, like, that's the thing. Like, I find it to be ridiculous. Like, and I also sort of think that if I really applied myself, I could probably get a girl to sit on my lap without paying her. That's how I view it. And it just, I don't know. Maybe I'm not versed in strip club etiquette and I don't understand what's going on, but I don't get the whole concept.
Ask for ones. Get a handful of ones and throw them at the stage. You know
what's funny? There was a John Westling, a comedian that's part of the Whiskey Brothers crew in Houston. We had this conversation once. He was like, do the $100 challenge. I was like, what's that? He was like, you get $100 and... you get $100, you break it into 20s.
I like this.
And you get $100, you break it into 20s, you buy one lap dance, and then you tell the stripper, this is all the money I've got, here's the rest of my $100, can you just work your way through it? And he was like, you'll leave happy. I was just like, no thanks. But it's $100! Like, again, I don't... feel like if I really apply myself, I don't feel like I have to spend $100 to get a girl to sit on my lap. I just, maybe it's egotistical of me, but I honestly think by being a nice person, I can attract the same sort of female attention by being a nice person that brushes their teeth, holds the doors, and is willing to.
How's that working out for you?
You know, I'm pretty confident that I could have somebody sit in my lap tonight if I wanted to, and I'm not saying that in an egotistical way. I'm just saying that, you know, I could probably, if I wanted to tonight, go out on a date. And if I really played my cards right, the girl might sit on my lap. We'll have to wait and see. All right.
But I'll follow you on Twitter to find that out.
I just feel weird if I spend $100 to get a girl. Anyways,
I'll have to visit my friend Adam to make sure tonight's a good night. I'll be right back.
My friend Adam, ATM.
Oh, right.
My friend Adam has all the money.
Oh, that's very funny. All right, so wait. Run the story down one more time.
Police arrested a stripper who bit a customer in the crotch while giving him a lap dance at a Wisconsin strip club.
Wow. Blatant violation of the penal code.
Oh.
Not really the kind of tip you want a stripper going after, I suppose.
To issue a retraction.
I disavow, okay?
Real classy. Let me move on.
Go on.
Playboy unveiled its first non-nude cover girl.
Yeah, you know, look.
No, don't want to look. Don't care.
You can love the past. You can cherish the past. You can even live in the past a little bit. You can learn from the past. But no matter how much you want to learn from and or live in the past, there's one thing you can't do. You cannot stop the clock. You can't turn back the hands of time. You cannot impede progress. Times are going to change whether you want them to or not. And that change has affected nudie magazines recently. So much so that they're not nudie anymore. Or they're not magazines. Penthouse. Like, it's affected Playboy and Penthouse. Penthouse has, you can no longer buy a copy of Penthouse sometime soon. I think they're getting ready to drop the last issue if they haven't already. But Penthouse is going to be all digital. How you hide your computer under your bed the same way is beyond me. But, like, Playboy instead has turned really into Maxim Magazine. Playboy have unveiled their first ever non-nude cover girl and their first ever non-nude issue. And they think that this will serve as an inspiration to millions. Right. It'll inspire millions to cancel their subscriptions and go look at porn on the internet. When we return, Cheap Trick are joining us in the studio. Thank you so much for hanging out.
AD on the radio. Back once again with ill behavior. Delivering and giving you my musical savior. Back once again, it's your boy AD again. Nobody rock a party better than me. Back once again with ill behavior. Delivering and giving you my musical savior. Back once again, it's your boy AD again. Nobody rock a party better than me.
So if you are just joining us, we are really just killing time. Excited. On edge, because we're being joined in the studio by Cheap Trick today, who are celebrating the fact that they're about to be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and they have a new album. And you know when, kind of like these bands that have been around for a little while come with new records, a lot of the time they're limited to a classic rock station. Our friend, the insane Daryl Wayne, he's got a show called The Latest from the Greatest, which is new music from bands that could be termed classic rock groups. And why is this show necessary? Because classic rock stations play old rock, and new rock stations don't really want to touch bands that have been around for a while when they come to drop new music. It's just this weird dichotomy that these legendary musicians find themselves in, and it's not right, and it's not fair, but it's just
good.
Yeah, exactly. But here's the impressive thing about Cheap Trick. They have bucked that trend. They're being played across all these amazing sort of like, well, amazing in that these are stations that usually wouldn't touch bands that formed in the 70s. Cheap Trick are being played on alternative and rock stations around the country.
Well,
why?
Because they continue rocks, to be. Dude.
Well, yeah, it rocks. But, you know, so did the new Def Leppard single. Like, it really did.
Oh.
Yeah, but it did not break through the way Cheap Trick are breaking through. I think that's because Cheap Trick have never stopped. It's like we said, it's the value of hard work. It's the value of being a working musician. It's the value of being a band that is out there and taking it to the people rather than resting on their laurels. And that's why Cheap Trick are breaking through in a way that a lot of other bands that formed in 1975 are not. Yeah, it's impressive stuff.
That's a long time.
Yeah, and we're talking about the value of work, and I thought it's kind of apropos as we get ready to talk to the dudes in Cheap Trick about the value of hard work and the effect it's had on their career to note that there's a 25-year-old woman in Minnesota. She's called Cesia Bears. I think that's how you pronounce her name. And she opened a restaurant in Minneapolis last year called Abby's Cafe. By the way, a 25-year-old that manages to start their own business, already I feel sort of dwarfed in terms of smarts and work ethic and all of the above. It's very, very impressive. But so far, business has been kind of slow. But the type of person who's going to start their own restaurant at age 25 and stay in business for a year, I mean, just first and foremost, most independent businesses fold within the first 3 to 6 months. So that's impressive that she's been in business for a year, even if business has been kind of slow. But what I found incredibly inspiring about her story is this. When a homeless guy walked in and asked her for change earlier this month, she said no. But then she asked him, hey, I guess you don't have a job. Why don't you have a job? And he told her, well, I can't find one. I have a criminal record. We don't know what this guy's full name is. We know his first name is Marcus. And if you look at the pictures, he looks like he's in his 40s, but 40s that have been hard lived. And he seemed like a decent guy who wanted to work to this 25-year-old woman who opened up her own business. So what did she do? She offered to pay him if he'd work for a couple hours washing dishes. And now for the past 3 weeks, he's been showing up on time, working 2-hour shifts whenever she needs help. And she said the thing that really got to her was when she gave him a sandwich after his first shift. The thing that really got to her was the fact that she gave him the sandwich and he only ate half of it. And then he walked outside and gave the other half to a woman who was also homeless. There's no word from this woman on how much extra business the story is bringing in, but it's free advertising. The original Facebook post about it has something like, I don't know, 60,000 shares, 200,000 likes. And look, this idea is not a magic bullet. It's not going to work every single time. If you employ a homeless person, it's not always going to end well for you. But the point is taking a chance on another human being, giving someone an opportunity. Giving someone an opportunity the way I'm sure somebody at some stage in the game gave an opportunity to you. And then reaping the rewards, having a job done well in a timely manner that helps your business thrive. And then succeeding because the rest of the world picks up on what you've done. I guess you'd call it the idea of conscious capitalism, the idea that there is money to be made. There is money to be made if you shift your paradigm and think, how can I not only thrive and make a whole bunch of loot, but how can I help other people doing it at the same time? Considering things like that can vastly impact the quality of your life. All right, then. You know how you said Cheap Trick were all trying to log into building Wi-Fi, Funkhauser? Yeah. Uh-huh. And you're concerned about what they might be surfing and how it could get you into trouble because they're using your password? Mm-hmm. You ever dealt with this situation where an ex steals your modem?
Oh, they were a pretty bad breakup last year. Yeah, let's talk about it. Okay, here we go. This is what happened. We were living together. He moved out. Then he waited till I went out of town, snuck back into the apartment, and stole the internet modem. Dude, just take a pair of my panties like a normal crazy ex-boyfriend. Who steals a modem? I didn't know I had one till he stole it. What is wrong with you? I didn't know what to do, so I called the cops. And they were like, we don't care. Yeah, they're like, you realize there are people being murdered? And I said, I do realize that. I'm calling to ask if I can have one of their modems.
When we return, we will be joined in studio by the dudes in Cheap Trick. So excited. We'll be right back. up, guys? How are you?
Hey, AD.
Good.
First interview of the day. Congratulations. All right.
I might have heard a couple of the previous ones.
Uh-oh.
don't worry.
Okay, well, you don't need to ask me those questions.
Yeah, you got some new questions for us?
Actually, well, have we officially started? Is this the interview? Yeah. I guess we should just do it. All right. Robin, Rick, Tom, and Dax, Cheap Trick, welcome to the show. Thank you for being here.
All right, man.
Before anything else, I've spent like the last 2 days listening to your new record constantly, and we don't have time to play the whole thing, but let's just hear a little bit of this. Can you guys hear this on your end?
Oh, yeah.
No.
Hey, AD, are you doing two stations, one Orlando, one Houston? Is that right?
One Orlando, one Houston. They spread me thin.
Oh, yeah. Well, you must be rich by now.
Ha! You'd think that. My goal for this year is to combine my 8 mediocre jobs into 2 really good ones.
Good thinking.
It hasn't happened yet. Let's listen to the music, though. Shh, shh. Stop talking over your own music. Now, there's a reason why I'm playing you this. Let's wait for the vocal to come in. Yeah, here we go. So, first and foremost, awesome, awesome record. But I'm listening to this record over and over again, and you guys could be on tour with the Killers or Imagine Dragons or the Bravery, and it would be a perfect fit. Like, I'm listening to this record, and whatever it is that Cheap Trick has, there's always been a distinctly youthful quality to it, and that hasn't gone away. But I gotta feel like the reason you would work... Oh, well, hold on. So good. Humongous. Windows down, volume up, driving fast. It's awesome. But I have to feel like the reason you would fit in so well with all these bands is that because they've all been studying the Cheap Trick songwriting handbook a little closely for the past 10, 15, 20 years. Do you ever hear bands playing and go like, you're welcome, we started that? Glad you picked it up.
But we don't hear too many thank yous.
Well, you should.
Actually, we're getting a big thank you coming up here. We're going to be inducted to the Hall of Fame, which is a pretty big thank you, I think.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, I mean, look, new album, Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction. And it just, when you listen to this record, you're just like, the breadth and depth of their work is just really something else. What is it like now on the verge of your induction into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame? Looking at each other going, all right, let's write a record or let's play a show. How is it different now to when you guys started out? Or is it the same?
I think it's pretty much the same. I mean, it's a Cheap Trick record. It's, you know, a little bit different chord-wise. The songs are different, but it's still Cheap Trick.
Yeah, you know, we've got diverse. I think that we've had that since our first record. And it's like, this one's no different. I mean, it's like... You know, we wouldn't want to have all of one sort of thing or one, but you know, it's like when we don't really put together the album in advance. We just do song by song, and it's like some fit right, and some fit, and some need to be onto a different record, and so it's kind of hard to decide. You know, choosing songs that you're going to put on it, because we recorded 8 songs in L.A., then we went on tour, then we recorded 7 songs in L.A., went back on tour, then we recorded 8 songs in Nashville, went back on tour and recorded another 8. So all of a sudden we had 30 songs, and so like wow, you know, like we had to. Narrow it down and finish them all. It's like,
and you know, we're a pretty diverse group. We write all kinds of material and stuff, but we're not AC/DC where everything's kind of linear. You know, we kind of jump around.
Yeah, no, you.
I like their linear. I like their linear, but that's not us. You know,
there's some bands that have made an awesome career out of writing the same song over and over again, and they're some of my favorite bands in the world. You guys are playing with all the colors in the palette, though. You definitely don't limit yourself in the same way a lot of other bands do. But, I mean, I'm talking more about the feeling that you get, like, looking at each other. Maybe you're getting ready to write a song. Or, okay, look, Cheap Trick has been a band that lived, thrived, and survived in the live arena. That moment where you're looking at each other about to go on stage now, what's it like compared to back in the day?
We don't look at each other.
We look at each other?
Hell, I can't even look at my face.
See back there.
I take all the mirrors off the walls in my house.
I've done that too. It's like, you know, it's like, you know, it's like, I don't really think about it myself. It's like, I say every night, I say, and here's my favorite lead singer in the whole wide world. I point to Robin. It's like, and it's like, yeah, I mean it, but, you know, but we don't go over and hug each other or do all kinds of stuff. That kind of stuff. It's really, I think it's a mutual respect, you know, that we probably we don't hang around each other 24/7, but at the same time, it's like I'm working with some of the best guys in the world. I mean, Tom is, you know, he's not Jaco Pastorius or what, you know, it's like, whatever his name
Jaco.
Is. isn't that the guy that,
whoever that is,
the South American guy. No, it's like, you know, working with some of the best people in the vein that we kind of all liked. I mean, rock, playing rock music. And it's not like we're not trying to be somebody that we aren't. We're not trying to be heavy metal. We're not trying to be, you know, all ballady or we're not. You know, it's like we're.
Hey, describing us is even difficult, you know. Listen to the records. That's pretty much us, you know.
I have a question from Joe McClure on Facebook, who it's a bit of a music nerd question, which we like around here. He was like, "Can you please ask Tom what made him come up with the 12-string bass? As a bass player, he was my first bass love." So, Tom?
What made me come up with it? Just one of the big sound, you know, something that sounded orchestrated and sounded like more than one person playing, so it's kind of like a grand piano, a guitar, a bass, and a kazoo all playing at the same time.
Because there's this theory floating around that it was like stringed instruments envy. It's like, you got five necks, big deal. I got 12 strings. How do you like them apples, Rick?
Well, you know, we're basically a three piece band, you know, guitar, bass, drums, and a lead singer. So it's like. Filling up that sound and filling up, you know, the parts. It was Tom started out as a guitar player, so it's like he could do what I'm doing, but you know, just people used to say, about the name Cheap Trick, they'd say, well, Cheap Trick, because you got other songs, other players somewhere, and you know, we knew when to make, we knew how to make fill up the sound with just really the guitar and bass, and by Tom adding having the 12-string bass, it's like nobody else can play it either. I mean, there's others who have played it, but nobody else can really play it like he does. And it made it kind of unique, because I mean, we're playing the same 12 notes everybody else does.
As you are getting ready to be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, a lot of people would argue that the recording at Budokan is sort of what brought your genius to the attention of the world. And not too many people have a snapshot of their moment in time, like 2 hours that changed their lives. Do you have, and this again is a question from Janet on Facebook, do you have a fondest memory from the concert there as you look back on it, as you reflect getting ready to head into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and drop the new record?
Holy cow, that's a mouthful there. let's see. In 1978, when we went to Japan for the first time, you know, we'd opened some big shows and we'd done some stuff, but we never really headlined that many things. It was, so we were, you know, we were the opening act for Kiss, we were the opening act for Queen, and so that was great stuff for us. And that was actually where we got some of the press and some of the notoriety with the Japanese people. So then we go there, and all of a sudden we're playing these huge places on our own and people knowing our music. I just thought, God, this is the greatest place on earth. You know, it's like,
wow.
You know, we left playing a bar in Iowa an hour before, and now here we are in Tokyo and 5,000 fans are chasing us around, and we're playing to sold out crowds. And our songs were, we had one of our songs, Clock Strikes 10, was a number one song in Japan. I mean, I don't think it got any airplay anywhere else in the world, but it was like, you know, it's like we had, by the time we were there, I think we had three hit singles, and it was like amazing. We had albums out and singles. It was like, you know, and back then in 78, how I relate to it a bit, it was before there was any sushi bars in the United States. You know?
Wow.
Nobody had sushi. That was brand new. And there was no Starbucks. It was, you know, it was a completely alien world.
Wow.
And there's no CNN either, right?
That was before that.
Not a lot of good viewing on TV there.
Definitely.
A lot of Japanese game shows.
I got a message from Adam who said, no question, but seeing you play Heaven tonight at Riot Fest was his highlight of 2014. And it brings up an interesting point. Live, look, you've had hit singles, you've had hit albums, but it seems to me like the secret of Cheap Trick's long-term success is the connection you have with the people that come to see you play live.
Besides having regular people that just like music, we have a lot of musicians that come to see us. So that's, you know, And if you get a musician that comes to see another musician and they actually applaud or they say something good to you or they give you the finger or whatever it is, you know, it's like it's pretty amazing. And so we got a lot of that stuff, you know, that for that show, I remember that Riot Fest that we played. They asked us to do, all right, you're Cheap Trick. You know, we're playing with all these bands, you know, newer groups and stuff. And they said, well, we'd like you to do your album Heaven tonight here. Okay. So, you know, we did it in its entirety from, you know, song one to the last song in order and, you know, then played other songs too. It was like, you know, for a lot of people that weren't even around when it came out, it was like, you know, these guys actually can play. And, oh, yeah, I've heard that. And it's like, God, it's so much, I mean, it's powerful live. And it was a lot of different musicians who came around. I remember Andrew W.K. was at our show and Patti Smith was there and
Primus,
you know,
Reeves from The Cure was there.
Yeah, so yeah, there's a lot of people there, and they come to see us, and here we are. And it's like holy cow, you know, unless we're playing with somebody on tour, it's very rare that we get to see anybody, and you know, to have these guys come to see us, it was like pretty amazing.
Oh, I mean, it really speaks to the depth of your influence that you mean just as much to like an 18-year-old now as you did to their parents when they were 18 and beyond. And people like Billy Joe Armstrong of Green Day, Billy Corgan, The Pumpkins, Eddie Vedder, Pearl Jam, Kurt Cobain, Scott Weiland of Stone Temple Pilots, all these people.
Well, name somebody I've heard,
point or another,
name somebody I've heard of.
All of them have said, if it wasn't for Cheap Trick, all of them have said, know them, pretty much.
Yeah, that's pretty high honor.
Well, there's just a reason why your music connects with people, and you know, I think it's you as people. I think it's you as musicians, and I think this is why you are connecting with the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame next week and being inducted. It should have happened a little while ago.
Yeah, that's right.
Ignore that.
You mean
we
got to live up to all those accolades?
Oh my God, we better be good.
Oh my God.
Yeah. Robin, Rick, Tom, Dax, thank you so much for your time. Head out, get the amazing new record, Bang, Zoom, Crazy, Hello, and enjoy their induction into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And as always, they will be coming to a town near you in the not-too-distant future, and it's going to be an amazing night that you don't want to miss. Cheap Trick, thank you so very much.
AD, what's your real name?
It's short for Adrian.
Oh, okay. I thought it was short for BC.
That's what I was going to say.
Okay, never mind.
As an English guy growing up in America, I got stuck with it. People, Adrian, that doesn't really work. We have to shorten that to something that guarantees you never get chicks. So
you
thank you guys very much for hanging out.
Thanks.
Yeah,
could have
called you Rick.
All right. Rick sounds like a guy that gets girls.
He does.
Not as much as Robin, but Rick does. Robin has, because, you know, you're Batman's sidekick. There's no two ways about it. There's a tremendous amount of appeal there.
I'll go with that. That sounds good to me.
I think
just
you're right.
So you know, FYI, this is going to be used as part of the interview.
Well, FUC.
You can edit it. ADBC, whatever.
Thanks.
Thank you.
AD. Whatever. Guys, thank you so much. Have a great one.
Thanks a lot.